Welcome to this edition of Valor Media. This is episode number 100 for January 3rd, 2022. I'm your host, Mark Appenzeller. Happy New Year. I am so glad you're joining me today. Not only is this the first Valor Media podcast of 2022, but this is a true milestone episode, number 100. Wow, I cannot believe that we've made it this far. When we started the Valor Media podcast in February of 2020, I really wasn't sure what we were getting ourselves in for. But Lori Riston and I have taken turns hosting over the period of almost 2 years now, and between the two of us, we have covered a wide variety of topics, some of which focused on personal development and spiritual growth in our Crisis to Thriving series, and others that were encompassing the whole idea of navigating through your vocation or business in our Valor Excel series. Here we are now, entering 2022, and as we're beginning this new year, I really wanted to kick things off with an episode focusing on a subject that I think is so important to think about whenever we begin a new year, and that subject is failure. I'm not kidding. I said failure. Now, you may think that is an incredible bummer of a subject for the first podcast episode of a new year. You might be thinking, well, why can't you talk about something exciting? Why can't you be upbeat and inspirational and motivational? And let me qualify things by saying I'm not talking about failure as something we should be allowing to happen. I'm talking about failure as something that we need to be acutely aware of so that we can make sure it doesn't come to pass. And if we've experienced failure, and let's face it, at some point we all have, then we need to be able to learn from what we've gone through so that we can take better steps and make more progress in the days to come. If you listened to the episode 2 weeks ago, I shared a quote from Mark Twain. He said, "Good decisions come from experience. Experience comes from making bad decisions." We really have to be able to learn from what we've been through so that we know what it is we're trying to reach for. I think it sounds a little counterintuitive, but the truth is, sometimes we have to look forward by looking back. And so today, I want to talk about all that in an episode that I'm entitling A Model Year. Now, the whole idea of building models is second nature to me. Model building is a lifelong hobby of mine. I've built model trains, model aircraft, model tanks from World War II. I really love being able to replicate in miniature all the details of whatever I see in the full-size real-life prototype. And I think the more detail I can cram into a small model, the more it takes on the essence of the real thing. The same holds true for me when I'm coming into a new year. I like to create mental models of what I hope to accomplish in the months ahead. Now, I'm no fan of New Year's resolutions. I think they're here today and gone tomorrow. But if I can build a mental model of what I want to do and put a lot of detail into it, it takes on a life of its own. I try to look not only at what it is I'm working toward, but what I'm working out of. What did I do wrong last year? What were the mistakes, the shortcomings? What were the potholes that I stumbled into? Because I don't want to do the same things this year. And so if I look back, then I know what it is I'm looking forward to. Now, because this is right after Christmas, there's a pretty high probability that at some point over the last several weeks, you may have seen at least part of the classic movie, It's a Wonderful Life. It's one of my all-time favorite films. It's one of those movies that I've basically memorized all the dialogue from. I think it is probably the most amazing performance ever by James Stewart, one of my favorite actors. The movie is considered to be the masterpiece of director Frank Capra. And it is a movie that has been treasured by generation after generation of viewers all over the world, particularly in the United States. It is considered to be an all-time classic in the realm of inspirational, motivational movie making. There's every heartwarming thing to be gleaned from it, and every one of us can draw some parallel from the characters we see with ourselves or people around us. George Bailey is such an amazingly drawn character, and Stewart's performance really brings him to life. Now, spoiler alert, I am going to talk about a couple of scenes from the film, but I figure at this point everybody's seen It's a Wonderful Life. And it's ironic because we look at that movie and we tend to think of it as an absolute runaway success. It is so revered, so treasured, so cherished today that we tend to think that at the time of its release, people must have flocked to the theaters and critics must have swooned over it. But that's not really the case. Now, when it was released in 1946, it was immediately after the end of World War II. And some modern-day writers have speculated that the film probably was suffering a little bit from people being burned out from all the strain of World War II. Even though the movie is incredibly inspirational, many scenes in the film take place during World War II. And in 1946, a lot of that was just a little too close to home. People wanted to move on to something else. And so, it was a bit of a box office flop. Now, at the 1947 Academy Awards, It's a Wonderful Life was nominated in 5 different categories. Best Picture, James Stewart was nominated for Best Actor, Frank Capra for Best Director, John Ahlberg for Best Sound Recording, and William Hornbeck for Best Film Editing. But you know what? It's a Wonderful Life did not win a single Academy Award. I find it very ironic that a movie famous for having a main character fixated on his own sense of failure was not really a success. 2 years later, 1949, at the Cinema Writers' Circle Awards in Spain, It's a Wonderful Life won for Best Foreign Film. Now, isn't that funny? It never got the acclaim and the recognition that it deserved in its own home country, in its own time. But 2 years later, in Spain, seeing it as a foreign film, it won Best Film. And now, many, many decades later, the movie is a massive success by any stretch of the imagination. I think it really goes to show that failure is something you have to define. We talk about failure so much. He's a failure. It was a failed attempt. I failed at it. And we like to think of failure as meaning final. But the good news is, failure, even though it looks permanent, is really temporary. It's only permanent if we allow it to be. It reminds me of a joke from the old Seinfeld TV series where Jerry Seinfeld was talking about how when he was a boy, his mother would say, "Now, don't eat those brownies before dinner. You'll ruin your appetite." And his reply was, "I can't ruin my appetite. If I just wait long enough, another appetite will come along." And the same thing holds true with failure. Not that we should wait for success, but success will come along if we learn from what caused us to fail in the first place. Well, some people, unfortunately, once they've tasted failure, simply shut down. But the true successful people, the ones who really not only find success, but understand what success is all about, they're the ones who embrace that failure, learn from it, and move forward in huge ways. Now, I talked about the film itself, but now I want to talk about what to me is the big takeaway for this discussion, and it's a scene that occurs in It's a Wonderful Life. But I'll tell you this, it's a scene you may have never even noticed. Now, people watch the movie and they're so engulfed in the love story of George and Mary. We see all the complex interplay from the different characters, the internal struggles, the joys, the fears, the doubts. And as great as all that stuff is, there is a scene, probably not much more than 10 seconds in length, that to me captures the deepest, most powerful essence of what this movie is all about. It's a scene that occurs very quickly at a time in the movie when things are really ramping up, and so I think most people either don't even notice that the scene is occurring or they quickly forget about it because things are moving so rapidly and there's so much dialogue. At the point in the film where George has learned that Uncle Billy has misplaced the money that he should have deposited at the bank, George returns home. It's Christmas Eve. He should be having a festive, wonderful time with his family, but he's beginning to unravel. He's experiencing the overwhelming waves of anxiety, pressure, stress. He feels anger and rage and frustration. Even though he did not personally misplace the money, he knows that ultimately he'll be held accountable. His entire future, all of his dreams, appear to be hanging in the balance. Now, the whole character of George Bailey is so skillfully developed in this movie that we really come to see that he's a lot more than just the average guy. He isn't just somebody who wants things out of life. George Bailey is somebody who knows how to think big. From the time he was a little boy, in the scene that we see where he's in the soda shop with Mary when they're little kids, and he's showing her copies of National Geographic magazine, dreaming of visiting exotic places. The first time that we see him as an adult, he's standing in a luggage store, ready to buy a suitcase, and he wants to make sure he gets one large enough that he can put stickers all over it for the many places he hopes to visit. That's George Bailey. So much of the drama in this movie comes from the fact that George Bailey is a visionary person. He's somebody who looks beyond what is directly in front of him, and he dreams of attaining high and lofty goals. So to me, the most pivotal scene in the movie is when George and Mary are standing in the dining room. He's really beginning to vent all of his frustration about what's happening to him. In the background, we see models that have been built by George. There are a couple of skyscrapers and a very elaborate bridge. Now, we're not told anything about those models. Maybe he built them when he was a teenager, or when he discovered that he couldn't go off to college. But at some point, he saw these things in his mind, and he knew that someday he wanted to make them come to pass. And so in the meantime, he built models of them. Not just basic models, but detailed models. Well, as the scene unfolds, George, in all of his frustrated rage, smashes his own models to smithereens. They're never mentioned again. The film goes on, it comes to the conclusion that we all know and love, but my question is, whatever happened to those models that George Bailey destroyed? Did he just sweep up the pieces and then move on? Later on, did he come back and rebuild the models and never really go beyond that? Or one day, did he end up building the real skyscrapers and the real bridges? We know the end of the movie. We know how George moved beyond that crisis in his life, but we don't really know what he did with the rest of his life. And so to me, there are some enormous takeaways for us, questions we can ask ourselves if we consider those destroyed models. It really comes down to failure and how we deal with it. So based on the conjecture of what George could or could not have done with those models as he moved through the rest of his life, I want to talk about how we can respond to failure in one of three different ways. The first one is this. If the undertaking that we failed at was a model of what we really wanted to accomplish, then we could just rebuild the model, do the same thing again, never try anything beyond what we tried before. And when we respond to failure in that way, we just stay in a safe place, and we content ourselves with recovering what we lost and never expecting anything more. Maybe we scare ourselves out of the whole prospect of dreaming or trying to attain. The second thing that we can do is that we can come back defiantly, exasperated by our failure, and we can dive right into trying to tackle whatever the big dream was head on without laying any practical groundwork or taking any concrete steps toward working out the issues that defeated us during the first attempt. In that kind of a scenario, vision is no longer the driving force. Frustration is. This approach, in my opinion, almost never can produce good fruit because it ignores the practical experience gleaned from our initial failed attempt, just like we talked about in the Mark Twain quote. And the third possible outcome is we can rebuild the model, learning from what went wrong before, and we can use it as a prototype for moving forward in a way that embraces our past history without allowing it to become a ball and chain that holds us back from the fullness of what our vision encompasses. I don't know what George Bailey did with the rest of his life. I know what I want to do with the rest of mine. Do you know what you want to do with the rest of yours? You know, Thomas Edison made over 10,000 attempts before he finally demonstrated what he considered to be the perfect incandescent light bulb in 1879. When he finally released that light bulb, he was asked by a reporter, "Well, how did it feel to fail 10,000 times?" And Edison's response was, "I didn't fail 10,000 times. The light bulb was an invention with 10,000 steps." Maybe you feel like there are 10,000 steps between where you are now and where you want to be in 2022. I hope you have big dreams for this new year. Maybe you have a desire to start a nonprofit or a small business. You might have some really sound ideas, some incredible things that would bless other people, that would provide some service that no one else is. But you don't know how to get started. You don't even know what the first steps would be. Or maybe you've already laid some groundwork. Maybe you've taken some steps and you kind of feel stuck in the mud. Or maybe, like George Bailey, you feel like everything you touch blows up in your face. Maybe you have some failures from the past and you've allowed them to hold you down and hold you back. If that describes you, Valor can help. We have a division of Valor Ministries called Valor Excel. We can provide a distillation of all the practical experience that we've gone through over the years as a small nonprofit and bring that knowledge base to you to help get you on the best possible trajectory toward whatever your visions and dreams are. It's not about us doing it for you. It's about us giving you concrete tools that will help you navigate your own way. We want to show you ways to truly do smart work and to move beyond any constraints from the past that are holding you back. You can reach out to us at info@valorxl.com, and someone from our team will get back in touch with you. We'll ask you some key questions about where you're coming from and where you want to go. You can learn more about the services we offer by visiting us on Facebook at ValorXL or our website, www.valorxl.com. As we move into 2022, we really want the Valor Media podcast to be a source of information, inspiration, and guidance to you. If you have questions, or if there are subjects that you think would be beneficial for us to discuss, please reach out to us at media@thevalorcenter.org. You can learn more about Valor Ministries by visiting our website, www.thevalorcenter.org. And while you're there, visit the products page to find some inspirational items, hats, t-shirts, mugs, that touch on the whole idea behind Valor Ministries, moving people from crisis to thriving. And you can also find us on Facebook at Valor Ministries. Please like and subscribe to this podcast. We publish new episodes each Monday. And if Valor Media is an encouragement to you, if it's a blessing to you, if it's an inspiration to you, would you consider benefiting us by financially assisting us so that we can bring you more content like this throughout the year to come? If so, you can make your tax-deductible donations securely online by going to www.thevalorcenter.org and clicking on the Donate button. Or you can send a check or money order to Valor Ministries, 324 East Antietam Street, Suite 104, Hagerstown, Maryland, 21740. Thanks so much for joining me today. Please come back for next week's podcast episode. And don't forget, both for now and in the weeks to come and in the years ahead, you were made to thrive.